In Forest Hills, a suburb of Pittsburgh about 10 miles east of downtown, once stood a historic gem, dating back to the early days of development of nuclear energy in the United States. This is the Westinghouse Atom Smasher. With a diameter of 30 feet and rising 60 feet into the air, it nearly reaches the heights of a four-story building. However, today it's beyond recovery. And it's overlooked. Most people have no idea that this device allowed scientists to revolutionize our understanding of energy. Not to mention, it's rumored to have some indirect connections to that famous atomic weapons project back in the 1940s. Unfortunately, however, in recent years, it's faced significant challenges in preservation, and its use has been completely abandoned. So stay tuned to learn why, as today we discover the history of the Westinghouse Atom Smasher. I'm your host, Ryan Sokash, and you're watching It's History. Before exploring the history of the Westinghouse Atom Smasher, it's crucial to understand the context in which this particular accelerator was built. James Chadwick's discovery of the neutron in 1932 opened new possibilities for nuclear research. You see, neutrons have no electric charge, unlike charged particles such as protons and electrons. This characteristic allows them to penetrate the nucleus of atoms without being repelled by the electrostatic forces that would typically deflect charged particles. And it's this unique ability of neutrons that enabled scientists to explore the structure of the atom and its reactions more deeply. For example, neutron irradiation allowed for the creation of artificial elements, such as Enrico Fermi's experiments in 1934 that led to the discovery of new radioactive elements. In fact, companies and governments around the world were interested in the potential application of these discoveries. The vision was that nuclear energy could not only revolutionize the arms industry, as later demonstrated with the atomic bomb, but also offered innovative solutions for power generation, advanced medical treatments, and new industrial technologies. So it was within this environment of innovation and exploration that the Westinghouse Electric Corporation decided to invest in constructing the Atom Smasher. It all began in 1937 when the Westinghouse Electric Corporation decided to embark on an ambitious project to build the world's first industrial particle accelerator. At that time, nuclear science was in its early stages, and the company positioned itself at the forefront with this innovative device. But let's rewind a bit to understand how the company got there in the first place. You see, the Westinghouse Electric Corporation, founded in 1886 by George Westinghouse in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, started as the Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company, only to later be renamed Westinghouse Electric Corporation in 1945. It finally became CBS Corporation in 1995, as we know it today. This American company primarily developed the production equipment for generating, transmitting, and applying alternating current electricity, otherwise known as AC. Anyhow, Westinghouse had a significant impact on several landmark projects. It was crucial in electrifying Niagara Falls, for example, making a milestone in hydraulic power generation. Additionally, its technology was used in the Interborough Rapid Transit Company facilities in New York, not to mention the Southside Elevated Railroad in Chicago, substantially improving public transportation. So, in that context, the Westinghouse Atom Smasher was conceived as part of a large-scale nuclear research program within the private industry, representing the first 5 million volt Van de Graaff generators ever built, which, dare I say, was an impressive technological achievement. Its design allowed the acceleration of subatomic particles to high speeds, facilitating the study of nuclear reaction with unprecedented precision. This type of accelerator used a system of moving belts and electrostatics to generate and maintain high potential differences essential for accelerating particles. But before we continue, we still need to further understand just what is an atom smasher. An atom smasher is the same as a particle accelerator. This device was used to study how atoms behave when struck by particles accelerated to high speeds. Imagine it as a cannon that fires tiny particles at atoms to see what happens. This process helped scientists better understand nuclear reactions and how to harness the energy that they release. So, in the 1940s, this large machine played a crucial role in experiments that led to the discovery and control of nuclear fission reactions. According to the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, thanks to the research conducted with the Westinghouse Atom Smasher and other laboratories around the world, the photofission of uranium was discovered, which, looking back, turned out to be an essential part of the nuclear energy generation process. Now, you might be asking yourself, did any of this pose danger to the neighborhood, and just how did it work? The Atom Smasher's generator used 5 million volts to accelerate particles through a vacuum tube that ran from the top of a pressure vessel to a target 47 feet below. These high-energy particles collided with target atoms, splitting them and creating nuclear energy. The main advantage of this generator was its constant voltage, which allowed for exact measurement of reactions. To better insulate the generator, the air in the chamber around the vacuum tube was kept at a pressure of 120 pounds per square inch, and surprisingly had an observation window. According to most sources, despite the high-voltage nature of these experiments, the Atom Smasher did not pose a significant danger to the neighborhood. The amount of radioactive materials was negligible, and safety measures such as the controlled pressure in the vacuum chamber ensured a safe environment for researchers and the community. Additionally, though it cannot be fully confirmed, some research conducted there was utilized by the Manhattan Project in the 1940s to build the first nuclear weapons. That's right. According to a newspaper article, the daughter of a researcher who worked on the Atom Smasher confirmed that some Forest Hill scientist had connection with atomic bomb development, and that the Manhattan Project sought the help of some employees for that work. The Manhattan Project was a research and development effort during the Second World War, led by the U.S. with the support of the United Kingdom and Canada. It was aimed at producing the first nuclear weapons. Under the direction of General Leslie R. Groves, and with the collaboration of prominent scientists such as J. Robert Oppenheimer, the project culminated in the creation of the atomic bombs that were dropped in Hiroshima and Nagasaki in August of 1945. This project, shrouded in secrecy, not only marked a monumental advance in nuclear physics, but also drastically altered the course of the war, as well as subsequent geopolitics. Although the Atom Smasher was essential for studying the use of nuclear technology and energy generation, their speculations about its possible connection to the Manhattan Project is actually less relevant to our story, so let's move on. Aside from the Westinghouse Atom Smasher, several other particle accelerators played crucial roles in the research of the era. Lawrence's cyclotron, invented by Ernest O. Lawrence in 1930, used a magnetic field to accelerate particles in a circular path, facilitating the investigation of new particles and nuclear reactions. It was also fundamental in atomic medicine and radioisotope production. And let's not forget the Cockcroft-Walton generator, developed by John Cockcroft and Ernest Walton in 1932. And this device used a voltage manipulator to accelerate protons to achieve the very first artificial nuclear fission by bombarding lithium with protons. Finally, there was the betatron, invented by Donald Kirst in 1940, and was crucial in the investigation of properties of electrons and radiation, and ultimately was influential in developing radiotherapy for cancer treatment. So, with so much going on at the time, Westinghouse's commitment to the nuclear field was solidified by 1947 when the Department of Electronics and Nuclear Physics was established under the direction of Dr. William E. Schaub, a pioneer of Atom Smashers, and all of Westinghouse's innovations of ideas that were previously unimaginable, ideas like reactors for submarine propulsion. Now, in addition to being a key figure in advancing nuclear physics, it also had some surprising innovations. In a pioneering experiment, Dr. Kwon Han Sun, a nuclear physicist at Westinghouse's research laboratories, developed a process for printing photographs by bombarding them with atomic rays. And in what is likely the world's first photograph created this way, Dr. Sun used the Westinghouse Atom Smasher as the subject. First, he took a negative of the smasher and converted it into a positive film. Then, he bombarded this film with neutrons to create the image. Although the same radioactive effect can be achieved with regular bright photography, Working with a positive sheet of film made the original negative more effective. Now, let's fast forward to more modern times, when, in light of all these accomplishments, the Westinghouse Atom Smasher was recognized as an electrical engineering milestone by the IEEE in a ceremony that took place in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, on May the 29th, 1985. The Milestone Program, established during the organization of the centennial year, celebrates events of significant relevance throughout the history of electric engineering, nationally as well as internationally. Over the decades, the apparatus faced decay and eventual demolition, marking the end of an era. In its early years, the Atom Smasher represented the pinnacle of nuclear research technology. However, science has a tendency to move on, meaning more advanced and efficient particle accelerators emerged. Moreover, during the 1950s and 1960s, nuclear research experienced a shift in focus. While it concentrated on discovering the fundamentals of atomic physics in its early years, over time, the attention shifted towards more practical and commercial applications, such as energy and medicine. The Westinghouse Electric and Manufacturing Company, like many other companies in the sector, adjusted its priorities to align with these new market demands. Investment in things like atom smashers ceased to be a priority, and resources were redirected towards projects that promised higher return on investment, as well as more immediate application of the findings. As a result, the Atom Smasher continued operation up until 1958, when it was replaced by a more modern Van de Graaff generator, which is still in use today. Although the Westinghouse Atom Smasher was technically operational until the end, it saw little use after the start of World War II. However, very ominously, it remained atop the building for many decades longer. Gary Silversmith of the investment firm P&L Investments in Washington, D.C., purchased the 9-acre property in 2013 and demolished the building that housed the famous steel bulb. Then, in 2015, he received an estimate of nearly $200,000 to restore the smasher and place it on a new base, according to press reports. Surprisingly, almost 60 years had passed, and the smasher was decommissioned, abandoned, and then finally demolished in 2005. And if you check the site out on Google Street Views, it's pretty stark, as you can see the before and after of the demolition. As it seems, the Atom Smasher has disappeared. Though it has been immortalized in a miniature replica at the Carnegie Space Center in Pittsburgh, this replica was added to the Miniature Railroad and Village exhibit, which includes other historic landmarks of the region, allowing visitors to appreciate the importance of the Atom Smasher in the context of Pittsburgh's industrial history, as well as its contribution to nuclear physics. Moreover, the Heinz History Center in Pittsburgh houses the Westinghouse Archives, providing valuable historical context about the company as well as its scientific contributions. These archives document the development and use of the Atom Smasher, as well as technological and scientific advancements promoted by the Westinghouse Corporation over the years. However, the real historical treasure is located in Westinghouse Park, nearly 5 miles from the famous Atom Smasher. This 10-acre city park occupies the former estate of George and Marguerite Westinghouse. During the 4 decades they lived and worked on this property, known as Solitude, it became a gathering place for numerous notable politicians, industrialists, and scientists. Among the visitors were congressmen and future president William McKinley, British lords or Nikola Tesla, who, according to some sources, lived at Solitude for several months. During his stay, Tesla helped develop a practical alternating current system that worked with Westinghouse's motors and generators, marking a milestone in the history of electricity. While the Atom Smasher represents some very important 20th century technological advances, Solitude reflects the early stages of innovation and experimentation that George Westinghouse fostered. Today, what was once a majestic mansion and carriage house has been replaced by a basketball court, a playground, and a walking trail. However, part of the family's history is still preserved beneath the park's surface. Archaeologists have unearthed a small portion of what remains of the old property, including an underground tunnel and several household items that are surprisingly well intact. After Westinghouse died in 1914, their son donated the land to an engineering society, which was later sold to the city for just a dollar. with the condition that it be turned into a public park and that the house be demolished, which happened in 1919. Although the family removed some of the items from the house, the rest just collapsed into the foundation. Even so, ultimately, years after George Westinghouse's death, 55,000 of his former employees contributed to erecting a bronze monument in his honor. We'll leave it there for today, but I hope you'll consider clicking that subscribe and join button. Otherwise, until next time, I'm Ryan Socash, signing off.